So today I'll be discussing about the models of BJT amplifier. So in the last class, in unit 3, we have discussed about the small signal amplifier and its implication in connection to our course on electronic circuits. Now today, our fundamental emphasis will be on the designing of the models of bipolar junction transistor. More specifically, today we'll be discussing two different models, namely one is known as the pi model of BJT and second one is known as the hybrid parametal model or H model. And subsequently, we will try to establish the equivalence between these two models. Now to start with, let us first observe the bipolar junction transistor BJT in its symbolic form. As you know, you have three terminals, emitter, base, and collector. Now, these are the three terminals of any BJT. I'm considering here an NPN type of transistor. So you have base over here, you have collector over here, and emitter. So three terminal device, base, emitter, and collector. Now equivalently, we can model this particular thing by means of a two-port network. As we have seen last day, we can model this particular device, bipolar junction transistor, by means of a two-port network. Now as you know, the two-port network is a kind of black box in which there are two different ports. One is known as the input port, and second one is known as the output port. So you have an input port over here. So obviously, for bipolar junction transistor, you have three different terminals, namely collector, base, and emitter. Now, whenever we are making any attempt to represent that particular device by means of a two-port network, so obviously, one terminal is considered to be a common terminal. So if you have the emitter terminal as a common terminal, then the configuration is known as a common emitter configuration. If the base terminal is considered to be common, then it is known as a common base configuration. And on the other hand, if the collector terminal is the common terminal, then you have the common collector configuration. So we'll be having three different configuration, CE configuration, CB configuration, and CC configuration. Now, the CE model or the common emitter configuration is the most general or most popular configuration. In most of the cases, you will find that the CE configuration is popularly employed. Obviously, this configuration is having some advantages. It is having some limitations. So as a matter of fact, people are using the common base configuration or common collector configuration. But to start with, it is better to deal with the common emitter configuration. Now, in case of common emitter configuration, emitter terminal is considered to be the common terminal. And we have the base terminal as the input terminal and collector terminal as the output terminal. So you have a base emitter as the input and collector emitter as the output. So for any common emitter amplifier, if I have a CE configuration kind of thing, it's a CE configuration. For CE configuration, we have base emitter. This BE, base emitter, is known as the input port. Base emitter is known as the input port, and since it's a common emitter configuration, so emitter should be there in both input side and output side. And CE, that means collector emitter terminal, is considered to be the output port. Similarly, for common base configuration, we have this emitter base terminal as input terminal and collector base terminal as the output terminal. And for common collector configuration, we have the base collector terminal as the input terminal and the emitter collector terminal as the output terminal. So obviously, whenever we'll be discussing the different modes of the operation, then we'll be having some further discussion on the related advantages and limitations of each of these configurations. Now, let us now restrict our discussion on common emitter configuration only. Now, in case of common emitter configuration, as you know, there are two different input ports. One is the input port, second one is the output port. And base emitter junction or base emitter terminal is known to be the input port of that particular amplifier or that particular two-port network. Now, if BE or base emitter junction being the input port, then you have to identify what about the input potential and what about the input current. So the input current is nothing but the small signal input current is nothing but the base current. So for BE, base emitter junction to be the input port, if BE junction to be the input port, we have the voltage between the base and emitter is known to be the input voltage and the base current IB is known to be the input current. So it depends upon the configuration of the amplifier. Now here we are considering base emitter is the input port. So in that case, voltage difference between base to emitter is known to be the input voltage, and the current is the base current, that is IB, which is known to be the input current for this particular configuration. Now look at the notation over here. Now we are considering VBE, both the voltage and this terminal are represented by means of the lowercase letter. Similarly, for the current, we have IB, small I, small b. So as you understand that whenever we will be discussing about the models of transistor or models of amplifier, we will be specifically identifying the small signal equivalent circuit for that particular amplifier. So that's why, as far as our last day's discussion is concerned, we have considered this lowercase letter, both for the voltage or the current, and as well as for the terminal, we are using the lowercase letter to identify that this particular voltage or this particular current is the small signal current or small signal voltage or time varying voltage or time varying current. Now let us move to the network model once again, the two-port network model. So we are modeling this by means of a black box once again, considering that it's a common emitter kind of configuration. So as you know, base emitter is the input voltage and base current is the input current. Now we have to identify that, or you have to understand that this base emitter junction of any BJT, of any NPN bipolar junction transistor, this base emitter junction actually acts like a diode. It's a PN junction diode for which the corresponding IV characteristics look something like that. If I have a So as you know, this is the voltage difference between base to emitter terminal. This is the base current. This is the base current IB. Now, how does it look like? Variation? As you know, the variation looks something like that. It's an exponential variation. Now, initially, we have biased the transistor. We have biased this PN junction at some particular level, at some particular point, which is known to be the base emitter quiescent voltage and base current, quiescent base current. Let us try to identify what is the value of this VBEQ. This is your VBEQ. Remember, I am writing in all caps. So it's a DC quantity, and the corresponding I current is IB or IBQ. Now, over and above this VBEQ, So this is the VBQ. This is the baseline VBQ. Now over and above this VBQ, I am superimposing a small signal, small current. I mean, a small variation of base emitter voltage like this. Let me redraw this part. So this is the VBQ value, and over and above this, we have a fluctuation of small signal voltage, VBE. Now, because of the change of this small VBE, the corresponding change occurs in the base current IB. So VBE is the driving force over here. Because of the change of VBE, you understand that corresponding change in IB occurs. And as a matter of fact, whenever there is a change in IB, it will subsequently make a corresponding change in IC, that is the collector current. And because of the change in the collector current, the collector to emitter voltage also changes. And accordingly, for a small change in the base current, you'll be having a large change in the collector current. Or in other words, for a small change in the base to emitter voltage, you'll be having a large change in the collector to emitter voltage, which simplify the gain calculation. That means VCE by VB, which is nothing but the gain value for this particular amplifier. Now, last day we have mentioned what is meant by the small signal analysis, or what is meant by the small signal. So whenever this variation, this delta VB variation, this VB variation over and above this VBQ, as long as this VB variation is small with respect to the thermal voltage, that is 25 millivolt at the room temperature, whenever this VB with respect to VT it is small, then I can consider that the slope of this particular exponential graph, I can treat this slope as a constant one, because you know it's an exponential graph, so e to the power x. So it is represented by 1 plus x plus x square by factorial 2 plus x cube by factorial 3 and so on. Now, if you find out the f dash, so this is fx as a function of x. Now, if you make the corresponding derivative, that means the variation of fx with respect to x, that is f dash x, if you want to find out the derivative, which will give you the corresponding slope of that particular graph, then exponential, so ddx of e to the power x, you know, it is nothing but once again, I can write it like e to the power x. So in the expression of e to the power x, you have the higher order terms, like you have the square terms, you have the cube terms and the higher order terms as well. So this slope is not a constant one. So slope will change. As x changes, the slope will also change. But if you make this approximation that, okay, the corresponding fluctuation in the base emitter voltage is small with respect to the thermal voltage, then in that case, I can consider this slope to be almost constant. That means e to the power x can be represented by means of some 1 plus x form. So in that case, I can consider that, okay, this part is remaining almost constant. So if it is like 1 plus mx kind of thing, then the slope is constant, like m. So if the fluctuation is small, if the fluctuation of this base emitter voltage is small, so in that case, the over and above this range, I can treat that this exponential graph or exponential nature can be approximated to a straight line. So under this condition, you can easily find out what is meant by the variation of this IB with respect to the corresponding variation of VBE. So as you know, the expression, perhaps you know, what is the expression for IB? So the expression for IB, so I am writing here, the expression for IB, this expression is represented as some IS by beta e to the power VBE by VT. I'm just neglecting this minus one term. Actually, the value is like e to the power VBE by VT minus one. So since the value is very large, e to the power VBE by VT, so that's why I'm just neglecting this minus one term over here. So this will give you IB as a function of VBE. Now, if I want to find out the corresponding variation of IV with respect to the variation of VBE, then this delta IV by delta VBE, which is nothing but IS by beta, I can take it as a constant. Then you have 1 by VT outside into e to the power VBE by VT. Now, whenever this particular calculation is carried out at the quiescent point, that means over here at this particular point, because so far we have made this assumption that since the fluctuation of this base to emitter voltage is very small, so I can consider that this slope is almost constant. So if I want to compute this slope at this particular point, then delta IB by delta VB measured at Q point, is equal to 1 by VT, I can take it outside, that is okay. Then we have IS by beta e to the power. Now, instead of writing VBE by VT, what I can write is VBEQ, because it is measured, it is calculated at the quiescent point. So VBEQ by VT. Now, what is that expression? This entire expression, IS by beta e to the power VBE by VT, what is that? This is nothing but the IBQ, the base current, quiescent base current. So this is nothing but your IBQ by VT, right? Now, what is all about this delta IB by delta VB at Q point? This is nothing but the reverse of the input resistance, because input resistance is nothing but the corresponding variation of the input voltage with respect to the variation of the input current. Now, here I have just calculated the slope. So dy by dx, we have calculated. So 1 upon this is will give you the expression for the input resistance, that is R in. So what we can write over here is R in, a small signal resistance, is represented by Vt, the thermal voltage, divided by IBQ. So as you must understand that this input resistance of this particular transistor over here, which is represented by Vt by IBQ, is a strong function of temperature, because Vt is known as the thermal voltage, so it's a function of temperature. And IBQ, which is the quiescent base current, and as you know, quiescent base current strongly depends upon the temperature. So this input resistance Rin is a function of the temperature. So how to put this over here in this model? So you have the corresponding variation. So this can be represented by, now we have Rin, which is connected over here like this, but remember, this is not an explicit resistance, just like a collector resistance RC or the base resistance RB. This is not an explicit resistance, but eventually we can identify that since there is a corresponding change, because of the change in VBE, there is a change in IB. So there must be some resistance, although its resistance is not a constant one, unlike your traditional or conventional resistance, a 5 kilohms resistance or 2 kilohms resistance, it's not a constant one, but it depends heavily on the temperature, on the room temperature. But you can always visualize the variation of IB with respect to the variation of VB by means of a resistance represented by Rin. So this is the base terminal, and this is the emitter terminal. The current that is flowing through this is known as the base current, that is IB, and the voltage that is developed across these two is known as the base to emitter voltage over here. So this is nothing but the modeling of the input side of this bipolar junction transistor, modeling of the input side of the bipolar junction transistor by means of this input resistance Rin, which will give you the understanding about the variation of the base current with respect to the variation of the base to emitter voltage. Now comes the output side. Now, you know, in the output side, if the common emitter configuration is selected, so what about the output voltage? Output voltage is the collector to emitter voltage. Now, collector to emitter voltage is the output voltage, and output current is the collector current. So once again, I can have this collector current as a function. Once again, I can represent the collector current as a function of the base to emitter voltage. So this collector current IC is represented by IS e to the power VBE by VT. I'm just neglecting this minus one term. So once again, this collector current is a function of base to emitter voltage. So we can easily calculate what is the change of collector current with respect to the base to emitter voltage. How can I represent this one? Del IC by del VBE. So this is nothing but the same calculation, IS into 1 by VT into e to the power VBE by VT. Now once again, whenever it is calculated at Q point, I'm assuming that the corresponding fluctuation is small, then this IS e to the power, so 1 by VT, you can take it outside, into, you have IS over here, e to the power, now I can write like VBE Q by VT. Now what is that expression, IS e to the power VBE Q by VT? This is nothing but the quiescent collector current. So I can write this like ICQ by VT. ICQ by VT, this quiescent collector current, ICQ by VT. Now, what is that parameter in the left hand side? You have del IC by del VBE measured at the Q point. So this particular thing will give you the variation of the collector current with respect to the corresponding change in the base emitter voltage. So collector current is measured at the output port and base emitter voltage is measured at the input port. So this particular parameter relates two variables in two different ports. One is measured at the input port, second one is measured at the output port. Unlike the input resistance, for input resistance, both the parameters, both the input input current and the input voltage, both are measured at the input terminal, this base current and the base emitter voltage, both are measured at the input terminal. But here, the collector current is measured at the output terminal and the base emitter voltage is measured at the input terminal. So it relates two variables at two different ports. So obviously, I cannot represent it like an input or output. Rather, I can represent it by some term which is known as a mutual or trans. And what is this one? I by V, that ratio is not a ratio of resistance. Rather, I can consider to be like a conductance, because I by V is not V by I. It's a conductance. So this particular parameter is known as a mutual conductance or transconductance and is represented by GM. So GM is equal to ICQ by VT. So what does this particular variable infer? This GM identifies the corresponding fluctuation of the collector current with respect to the base to emitter voltage. So this is nothing but ICQ by VT. Now, so far we have assumed that this the collector current is not a function of the collector to emitter voltage. So far we have assumed that collector current is only a function of base to emitter voltage. And how does the collector current change with respect to the change in the base to emitter voltage is represented by this variable, which is known as GM. So if I want to go back to the previous slide once again, and if I want to represent this one over here, so you have a collector current. You have a collector current. So this is the output port. You have a collector current. So as far as our notation is concerned, I'm assuming that this direction is a positive direction for two port network. So this is IC, collector current. Now the collector current is represented by one current source. Represented by one current source whose magnitude is given by GM times the input voltage. So what was the input voltage? If I assume that the voltage difference over here is represented by like V in, so it is represented by GM times V in. GM times V in is the collector current. So IC is equal to GM times V in. So remember, once again, it's a small signal model. So this V in always is going to be modified depending upon the base current superimposed over here. And GM is a transistor parameter, and it's a strong function of the temperature, and it can be represented by this ICQ by VT. It's a mutual conductance or transconductance. So GM times V in. So that is the simplest possible model for the small signal amplifier, for the bipolar junction transistor, which is used as an important element to a device in a small signal amplifier. Now, so far, we have assumed that this collector current is not a function of the collector to emitter voltage. But if we look at the corresponding fluctuation over here, this output characteristics of any BJT. If you just observe the fluctuation, the output characteristics, so VCE and IC over here, you'll see that the graphs are represented by this. As you know, these graphs are drawn for different IB. One for IB1, second one is for IB2, third one is for IB3, and so on. And you have different regions of operation. You have the cutoff region, you have the active or linear region, you have the saturation region. So suppose this is for example, this is for IB1, this is for IB2, this is for IB3, this is for IB4, this is for IB5, and this one is for IB6. So you have six graphs, so there could have been plenty of graphs. Now I have drawn only six graphs for example for understanding. Now here you see that even if the baseband is constant, so baseband constant means your base to emitter voltage is constant. So if the even if the baseband is constant, you see that if the collector to emitter voltage increases, VC from this point to that point, as VC increases, the corresponding IC is also increasing. So from this graph itself, you can understand that the collector current is not only a function of the base current, it's not only a function of the base to emitter voltage, but also it's a function of the collector to emitter voltage. Because if the base emitter voltage is small, so you have the collector current is small because the base drive is small. If the base to emitter voltage is moderate, like IB3 or IB4, your base current is moderate and the collector current is also moderate. And if the base to emitter voltage is very large, from IB5 to IB6, then also the collector current is very large. So one thing is very clear, that this collector current is a strong function of the base to emitter voltage. But the story doesn't end here. The collector current is also a function of the collector to emitter voltage. Now, if we just extrapolate all these graphs, perhaps you know this from your understanding in the device physics, you see that this voltage, if you just extrapolate all these graphs, they will meet at a point. And this point is known as the early voltage, which is typically very large, VA, known as early voltage, typically very large in the order of 200 to 400 volt. It's a very large early voltage. So accordingly, the expression of the collector current, so far we have represented the collector current by this. So we have written like IS into e to the power VBE by VT only. So identifying that it's not a function of a collector to emitter voltage. But remember, because of this early effect, perhaps you have studied this one in your basic electronics course, that because of this early effect, apart from this variable IS and e to the power VBE by VT, you have another term which is a function of. So you have 1 plus, so IC is equal to 0 whenever your collector to emitter voltage is equal to PA. So this is represented by the function of collector to emitter voltage VCE by VA, 1 plus VCE by VA. So this is the complete model for the collector current. So it's a function of both base to emitter voltage as well as for collector to emitter voltage. So from this equation, you can understand that the collector current also depends upon the collector to emitter voltage. So accordingly, we can relate another variable, which will give you the fluctuation of collector current with respect to the corresponding change in the collector to emitter voltage, delta IC and delta VC. And once again, assuming the model of small signal analysis, we can compute this at the Q point. And if you calculate this, what you find is you have IS e to the power VB by VT. So that could have been taken constant over here. Then you have, so with respect to VCE, you have 1 by VA outside. And that could have been approximated to, although this is not exactly equal, IS e to the power VB by VT, although it is not exactly equal to IC, but or ICQ. So this is represented by ICQ by VA. or VA by ICQ, that is the 1 by resistance. So R naught, the output resistance R naught, is represented by VA by ICQ. VA by ICQ, because we have computed the variation of collector current with respect to the variation of the collector to emitter voltage measured at the Q point. Now this is what, so what about the unit of this particular parameter? We have the current at the numerator, voltage in the denominator. So unit will be the 1 upon resistance. So 1 upon resistance, and whether it's an input or output or trans, it is output, because both the variables are computed at the output terminal, C and DC. So this is the output current, this is the output voltage. So both the variables are computed in the output terminal. One is the delta IC, second one is the delta VC. So the ratio is the inverse of a resistance. So if I just inverse the entire thing, so this is 1 upon R naught. So 1 upon R naught is equal to ICQ by VA. So R naught is equal to VA by ICQ. So accordingly, we can represent this one as a Norton equivalent resistance over here. So here you have a Norton equivalent resistance. We can represent this one, the fluctuation of IC with respect to the corresponding fluctuation in VCE is represented by this Norton equivalent resistance like this. So this is your R naught. So this voltage is the collector to emitter voltage, VCE or V out. You can also write like V out. So this is V in, this is V out, or VCE for common emitter configuration, this is VCE. So accordingly, we have a three component model. Only you have one resistance at the input side, one resistance at the output side, and one voltage dependent current source in the output side. And these three resistance will constitute, three components will constitute the small signal model of a transistor over here. And if I just connect these two together, because both of them are same, the emitter terminal, if I connect these two together, so it will look something like a pie if I just observe. So here you have a connection like, you have a shape like this, a shape like this, inverted pie kind of this over here. So that's why this particular model is known as the pie model of the BJT. Is very useful and very popular model for the analysis of different types of variables, like, or different types of parameters, like the voltage gain, the current gain, and the input resistance, output resistance of amplifiers. It is very useful, this particular model. This is known as the pi model. So let me once again finalize what we have said so far. So in the pi model, we are representing the bipolar junction transistor by means of only three variables or three parameters, three components. This is the black box. But remember that we don't have this resistance, this current source explicitly. The model means something which will give us the false impression about what is there inside the circuit. We cannot observe what is there, but we can just anticipate what could have been there depending upon the input and output relationship of the current and voltages. So you have input port over here. You have output put over here for common emitter configuration. You have, I can write B base terminal over here, emitter terminal over here, collector, emitter. Now you have this R in, and since it's a pi model, so it is pretty much favorable to represent this resistance by R pi. Popularly, this resistance is known as R pi, and this voltage dip drop across the R pi is known as the V pi. And the output side, you have one current source whose magnitude is Gm times input voltage. So here the input voltage is represented by V pi. So I can write this like Gm times V pi over here. And so these are connected, and I have this Norton equivalent resistance over here, R naught, which will give us the fluctuation of the collector current with respect to the corresponding fluctuation in the collector to emitter voltage, GmVπ and R naught. Now remember, that this value of R naught is very large, because so far, let me once again write down the expression for each of these variables what we have discussed so far for your easy understanding, and you have to remember this one in many of the occasions in the entire discussion of these amplifiers and feedbacks and so on. So to start with, we have this input resistance R pi. So this R pi is a small signal input resistance, which is represented by Vt by IBQ, and it's a function of temperature. And Gm is the transconductance, is represented by ICQ by Vt, and R naught, the output resistance, is represented by Va by ICQ. Now, typically, now let us observe the what could have been the typical values for these parameters R pi, Gm, and R naught. Typically, the thermal voltage is in the order of millivolt. So at room temperature at 27 degrees centigrade, I can consider the Vt, the thermal voltage, to be of say 25 millivolt. So normally, if I assume that Vt is like 25 millivolt, and normally the base current is in the order of microampere, the quiescent base current is in the order of microampere. So if I represent it like 5 microampere kind of this, so I can easily calculate. So basically milli by micro. So irrespective of the absolute values, whether 25 or 5 or 8 or 7, but typically these orders are important. This for thermal voltage, order is millivolt. For base current, the order is, for quiescent base current, the order is in the order of microampere. So milli by micro. So that's why the R pi, or the input resistance of this transistor amplifier, input resistance is in the order of few kilo ohms. So for the sake of simplicity, I've assumed like 25 and 5. So if I divide it, then it will become like 5 only. So 5 kilo ohms. So it could have been anything like 2.5 kilo ohms, 3 kilo ohms, 4 kilo ohms, 5.5 kilo ohms. But most importantly, the unit of this particular thing, the order will be in the order of like kilo ohms, not mega ohms or ohms. Normally, it will be in the order of kilo ohms, is R pi. So severely large, this one. And similarly, you can also calculate the Gm value, Gm ICQ by Vt. So 1 upon that, because ICQ is like, if the IBQ is like 5 microampere, so ICQ would be like, say, 500 microampere. So accordingly, 1 by kilo multiplied. So let us take some typical value for Gm as well. So Gm, I can write ICQ. So let it be like 500. If the current gain is 100, so 500 microampere divided by, say, 25 millivolt. So it will give us like 20. And micro by milli, it will give us milli, 20 milli mho, or it's close to like 0.02 mho. So typically like this Gm value. And what about this R naught? R naught is the ratio of Va by ICQ, and as you know, the early voltage, the magnitude of early voltage is pretty large, in the order of few volts, a few hundreds of volts. So like 200 volts or 400 volts. So typically, if I assume that Va is like, for example, if I assume that it is like, say 400 volt, for example, ideally it could have been infinite, but practically it's very large. So like 400 volt over here. So in that case, R naught is represented by some 400 volt in the numerator, or 200 volt in the numerator, divided by ICQ, ICQ in the order of say 500 microampere, that means 0.5 milliampere. So 400 by 5.5, so it will give us like 800, then volt by milliampere will give us like kilo ohms kind of thing. So 800 kilo ohms. So it's very large, in the order of few hundreds of kilo ohms or mega ohms. So typically R naught is very large. So as a matter of fact, for any practical calculation, we cannot neglect the value of R naught. But if I go for any rough end calculation, for approximate calculation, we can safely neglect this R0 because it is there in the shunt path. R0 is connected over here. And since the variation is pretty small, because once again, if we just observe the corresponding slope of this graph, the set of graphs, if we just observe the corresponding slope, this slope is, if I just observe the slope of this graph, because the slope will ultimately signify what is the value of this output resistance, because it's nothing but IC by VCE. If we just observe over here, it's nothing but the variation of IC with respect to VCE. Now, if I just calculate the slope, 1 by slope will give us the output resistance. See, the slope is very small. It's not a very steep one. It's a flat one. The slopes are very flat. It's not like this, but it's pretty steep. It's not like this. And this been like, if the slope is like this much in the linear or active region, then you can say that, okay, its slope is very steep. So in that case, if the slope is steep, so dy dx is very large. So in that case, 1 by dy dx will be less. So here the slope is very flat. So we have a flat slope kind of thing. So delta IC by delta VC is very small. So 1 upon output resistance is very small. So in other words, the output resistance R0 is very large. So R0 is very large. So there could have been a very slight dependence or very insignificant dependence of the output current on the collector emitter voltage or the output voltage. But if I go for a practical calculation, we cannot neglect R0. But for rough end calculation, for easy calculation, we can safely neglect this R0, which is connected in the shunt path. So these two together, these three components together, obviously these points, I mean, these two terminals are connected because both of them are the emitter terminal. So they should be connected kind of this. So you have R pi, you have GM V pi, and you have R0. So these are the three different components in the pi model of transistor. Now, once again, there is a simple relationship which I must not forget to mention. So let me mention the relationship over here. R pi is represented by Vt by Ib cube, as you know. And Gm is represented by Icq by Vt. So if I multiply these two together, Gm and Gm with R pi, we get like Icq by Vt multiplied with Vt by IBQ. So this is nothing but ICQ upon IBQ, which is nothing but the beta DC, DC gain of DC current gain of the amplifier. So GM R pi is an important relationship. GM times R pi is equal to our good old beta, that is the DC current gain of the transistor. So GM R pi is equal to beta. An important relationship we must not forget, that these two parameters, GM and R pi, they are related by the transistor configuration, or basically the transistor parameter. So once again, if I make any attempt to change the transistor or replace the transistor by a different one, so the variables GM, R pi, they will be modified. And even for the same transistor, if I operate at two different temperatures or three different temperatures, then you'll see that the individual value for this GM and R pi could have been modified. Now, having discussed the first model of a bipolar junction transistor for our analysis of those devices during the calculation of different variables, now let us move to the another model, another important model, and which is normally used in most of the two-port network. And let us try to establish the equivalence between these two models. Now it's a two-port network. So you have the input port, you have the output port. Now input port is normally represented by port 1, This is normally represented by port 1, and output port is normally represented by port 2. So there are two different variables, both at the input terminal as well as the output terminal. What are those two variables? One is the voltage V1 between these two points, which is nothing but the input voltage or the voltage at the input port. And second one is the voltage at the output port V2. And the second part is the current. The current that is flowing inside the black box through port 1, I1, and the current that is entering the black box, this two-port network, through this I2. So this is basically the two-port network. And we are now interested to represent a bipolar junction transistor by means of a two-port network. So there are four variables, V1, I1, V2, and I2. So obviously, I can have the dependence between the variables. Remember that these variables are not independent to each other. One variable is related to the other variables as well, depending upon the components which are there inside the two-port network. So always, I can represent one variable as a function of the other variable. So there are four variables over here, V1, I1, V2, and I2. Now I can take two variables as the input variable and two variables as a dependent variable and two variables as an independent variable. So let us consider that dependent variables are V1, that is the voltage at port 1. V1 is one dependent variable, and I2 as the second dependent variable. So I can have two dependent variables. So I am representing this as a function of two independent variables. One is I1 and second one is V2. This is, for example, I'm representing like H11 I1, H12 V2. You understand why I'm writing like this, H11, H12 like this. And we have I1 over here. So I1 and V2, these are the independent variables. So I'm representing these other variables, V1 and I2, by means of these two dependent variables. So you have H21 over here, H22. So gradually we understand why the term H11, H12, H21, and H22 are there, why H is important over here. So now we can represent this input voltage V1 as a function of two variables, I1 and V2. So make no mistake that V1 and I2, they are the dependent variables. They are the dependent variables, and I1 and V2, they are the independent variables. So they are the independent variables. So in JIT parameter, so this is known as H parameter model. So in JIT parameter model for a two-port network, which you will study perhaps in the circuit theory course, then here you will see that I am representing V1 and V2 as the dependent variables. So V1 and V2 are represented by I1 and I2. So in that case, I1 and I2 are the independent variable, and V1 and V2 are the dependent variables. Now in H parameter model, we are selecting V1 and I2 as a dependent variable, and I1 and V2 as the independent variable. Now why it is known as H parameter model? So let us try to understand clearly why it is known as an H parameter model. Now let me once again write down the expression. V1 is equal to H11 I1 plus H12 V2, and I2 is equal to H21 I1 plus H22 V2. Remember that all these variables, v1 i1 v2 i2, they are the small signal variables. So that's why I am deliberately writing in terms of the lowercase letter, all small. So how do you calculate the dependent variables, this h11 h12 h21 and h22? So how to calculate h11? So h11 is nothing but this v1 by i1 with v2 is equal to 0. What about h12? So h12 is equal to v1 by v2 with i1 is equal to 0. How to write h21? h21 is nothing but i2 by i1 with v2 is equal to 0. And what about h22? h22, this is nothing but i2 by v2 with i1 is equal to 0. Now look at the beauty. So there are four variables, h11, h12, h21, and h22. Now out of these four variables, all of them are having different units. V1 by I1, so it's a ratio of the voltage to current. So this particular variable is having a unit of resistance. Now h12, it's a unit of two similar quantity, two voltage, V1 by V2. So it's an unitless quantity, h12. Secondly, we have h21, which is the ratio of I2 by I1. Once again, it's a unitless quantity. And what about h22? This is the ratio of a current to voltage. So this particular thing is having a resistance, a unit of trans resistance or conductance. It's a conduct, not trans, it's conductance, unit of conductance. So we have impedance over here, we have conductance over here, and these two are the unitless quantity, h12 and h21. Now h11 is v1 by i1, so it's a ratio of the input voltage to the input current. So therefore, I can always regard this h11 as R pi, or I can always regard this as like an input resistance. Similarly, for h22, this is nothing but the output current over output voltage. So ratio of I2 by V2. So I can always regard this quantity as output resistance, 1 upon output resistance, because it's a ratio of I by V, so 1 upon output resistance or output conductance. And what about the other two, V1 by V2? The reverse voltage gain. Because normally, if V1 is the input port and V2 is the output port, so V2 by V1 is known to be the voltage gain. But here it's known as reverse voltage gain, because V1 by V2 over here. And for H21, this is the forward current gain, I2 by I1. I2 is the output current, I1 is the input current. So current gain is represented by this H21. So if I just observe the units of these variables or these different parameters, then here you'll see that H11 is having a unit of resistance, say ohm. H12 is unitless, H21 is also unitless, and H22 is having the unit of 1 upon resistance, that is mho. So there you have the different types of variables, impedance, admittance, and you have the unitless quantity like voltage gain, current gain. So all the hybrid kind of thing, all the different types of variables are present by means of these four things, H11, H12, H21, and H22. So that's why they are known as the hybrid parameters, because they have all the variables present. Current, you have the current gain, you have the voltage gain or reverse voltage gain, you have the impedance, you have the conductance, so all the variables are there. So that's what is known as a hybrid parameter, H parameter. So that's why we have represented by H, not other variables. And if you just look at the condition, so I have grouped together this H1 and H21, these two variables, H11 and H21, they are computed with output circuit shorted. V2 is equal to 0. That means the output terminal must be short circuited in order to obtain this H11 and H21. And what about this H12 and H22? They are obtained when I1 is equal to 0. What does it mean? I1 is equal to 0 means input circuit, input side, input port is open circuited. That means there is no flow of current. So not only they are hybrid in nature, but also their computation or their calculation is carried out in two different scenario. In one case, the output circuit is short circuited, for which you can calculate H11 and H21. And for the other case, in order to calculate H12 and H22, the input circuit is open circuited. That means I1 is equal to 0. Now, this is so this particular representation, a two-port network by means of this hybrid parameter model. So this is a generic one. So for if you just open any book on circuit theory, you'll see that this kind of representation is there. Now, as far as our syllabus is concerned, or as far as our curriculum is concerned, so how can I model this a bipolar junction transistor by means of a two-port network? So this is our question. So now let us remodel this entire thing in the framework of bipolar junction transistor. So there are two ports, input port and output port. And suppose I am modeling any bipolar junction transistor operated in common emitter configuration. So for common emitter configuration, as you understand, that this terminal, I mean, this is the base terminal. This is the emitter terminal. This is the collector terminal. And this is the emitter terminal. So emitter is the common to both the input and output. Base terminal is the input terminal and collector terminal is the output terminal. Now let me write down the expression once again. So here, instead of writing V1, what should I write? Instead of writing V1, so here one, as you know, one is nothing but the input port, two is the output port, symbolically. So here, instead of writing V1, what we can write is we can write VBE, because this is the input voltage, VBE. For common emitter configuration. So this can be represented by H. I'm not writing right now the subscript H11. So 11 should be represented by something multiplied with I1. So I should write I1. So 1 is nothing but IB. Then another H parameter multiplied with the output voltage V2. So instead of writing output voltage, what should I write? I should write VCE. Similarly, for the second equation, I can write the output current I2. So I2 is represented by IC. I2 is IC. So IC is some H multiplied with IB plus another H multiplied with VCE. Now try to understand what are those four different H's. So here this is H, which is nothing but the ratio of VB by IB with VC is equal to zero, output short circuited. This is the ratio of VB by IB. So unit is of impedance. So that's why we are representing this by HI. And since it is under common emitter configuration, so that is why it is written by HIE. Similarly, here is the ratio of VB by VC. So with IB is equal to zero, so what is VB by VC? This is nothing but the reverse voltage gain. VB by VC, reverse voltage gain. So that's why HR, standing for reverse voltage gain, and HRE. Here, this H relates the output current to the input current IC by IB with VC is equal to zero. So forward current gain. So that's why HFE. And here we have the output current by output voltage IC by VC with IB is equal to zero. So this is nothing but conductance. So HOE. So output conductance. So HOE. E stands for emitter. So ultimately we have VB is equal to HIE IB plus HRE VC and IC is equal to HFE IB plus HOE VC. So this is a model of the transistor. A bipolar junction transistor operated in common emitter configuration. Now let us try to populate this entire thing inside this black box. Let us try to populate. Before that, let us show those variables over here. So as you know, this is the VBE. This is VCE. The current entering into the network is represented like a forward current here, and here the current is IC. Now try to understand what is there inside. Now VBE, if I just go by the first equation, you have HIEIB. So there is a KVL. For the first equation, there is a KVL. And you have HREVC. So this is nothing but a voltage source, voltage dependent voltage source. So this is your HIE. And this is HREVCE. Now here in the, for the second equation, you have a KCL equation. So IC is the current that is entering this two port network. IC is the current. Now this current is divided into two different components. So accordingly, let me draw two different sources over here. One is the first current source, which is nothing but HFE times IB. And second one is this admittance. So admittance is there, 1/HOE. So the resistance is 1/HOE. So there are basically four elements, HIE, HREVCE, HFEIB, and 1/HOE. So four elements are there in this hybrid parameter model. HIE is the input impedance, I can write HIE. Second one is this HREVCE. This is the voltage dependent voltage source, because obviously in this particular expression, here we have VBE. So obviously it's HIB and HREVC, both of them are voltages. Now HIB is the current, the base current. So HI is the impedance or input impedance. So impedance multiplied with the current will give you the voltage. Now here we have HREVC. So remember, this entire thing must be a voltage source. And how does this voltage source change? This voltage source depends upon the voltage at the output terminal. So that's why it is known as a voltage dependent voltage source. So who is controlling this voltage source? VC, the output voltage controls this voltage source. So that's why HREVC is the voltage dependent voltage source. Similarly, for the second equation, we have a KCL equation over here. So both of them, both of these two quantities are the currents, HFEIB and HOEVC. Now here, this is the current source, current dependent current source, HFEIB. So HFE is the current gain, forward current gain over here, HFEIB. And we have this, the last component, another component. So we have a VC over here. So this is connected across these two points along the output terminal. So HOE is nothing but the corresponding conductance. So if I want to represent by means of resistance, so the value of the resistance will be 1/HOE. So we have two models by our hand. One is the H parameter model and second one is the pi model. So in case of pi model, we have seen that there are three elements. One is R pi, second one is GM times V pi, and third one is the R naught. And here we have got another additional component, this HREVC. But remember that the value, since we are considering the BJT operated as an amplifier, so there should be a voltage gain. So the input voltage, if I consider this VBE, this input voltage is much, much small as compared to the output voltage, because that is the purpose of an amplifier, to magnify the voltage signal. So the input side, you have an input voltage like VBE. The output side, you have a voltage like VCE. So VCE is much, much higher as compared to VBE, almost 100 times or 500 times higher, depending upon the gain of the amplifier. So as a matter of fact, this HRE, which is known as the reverse voltage gain, is very small. The magnitude of this variable, HRE, is pretty small. So sometimes, since it is very small, so you can neglect it to zero. In that case, this H parameter model will be represented by the simple three element model, just like your pi model. And we have HIE over here. So HIE is very much similar to the R pi value. We have HFEIB over here, the current source over here. So this HFEIB is nothing but your GM times V pi. So we'll be establishing whether these two equivalents are correct or not. And we have a R naught over here. So R naught is nothing but 1/HOE. So this four element model can be equivalently represented by, or equivalently approximated by, a three element model, considering that HRE is very small, or close to zero. Now, before establishing the equivalence between these two models, now let us explore what is the extended hybrid parameter, extended pi model. Now for x, so far we have seen that for pi model, for pi model you have three elements. We have only three elements. You have r pi over here. Gm v pi, the current source over here. And you have r naught over here. So these three elements are there. So this is an approximator model. So in order to find out, so this is r pi. So this one is Gm times V pi. And this voltage drop is basically the V pi. And you have R naught over here. Now for extended pi model, two additional parameters are introduced. One is known as the series resistance. So the series resistance is nothing but the resistance of a semiconductor material between the external base terminal. So this is the external base terminal where we are basically applying the input signal. And this is the idealized internal terminal. So this is the internal terminal, internal to the transistor. So this is, let me represent it by V dash. And this is the external base terminal at which we are applying the signal source. So between these two points, we have a small resistance. So for many calculation, we can safely ignore this. But if you're pretty much accurate, you can introduce this one. So this one is known as RB, the small resistance which is there between the idealized, this is the external terminal, external base terminal, and the idealized internal terminal. A small semiconductor resistance is there in the form of RB. And additionally, between this base to collector, since there is some feedback, so there could have been some diffusion resistance in the form of R mu. You have two resistances over here. One is RB, series resistance, and second one is the R mu, that is the shunt resistance. Normally, the typical value for RB is very small, in the order of few tens of ohms. So that's why in most of the practical applications of a rough end calculation, we can just neglect those variable, I mean this RB. Now on the other hand, this R mu, this is typically very large, which relates or which identifies the dependence of this input side with respect to the output side. That means there is a kind of feedback existing in the form of R mu. Typically, the value of R mu is very large, in the order of few mega ohms. So for rough end calculation, we can safely neglect this R mu. But if you are pretty much accurate, then you can you have to introduce this R mu for your calculation. So this is the extended pi model. So where we have introduced two defined variables. One is RB. Second one is the R mu, and additionally we have three variables. Like previously, we have R pi, we have Gm times V pi, and we have this R naught. And obviously, these two terminals are connected because both of them are the emitter terminal. So I can always connect these two terminals together. Now, having considered this is the extended pi model, and we have already at our hand the small signal, I mean the H parameter model. Now we are in a position to find out the equivalence between these two. That means whether these two variables, or I mean these two models, whether they are equivalent or not, or whether there is an equivalence or not, and if there is an equivalence, then what is the equivalent relationship that you have to establish. Now let us start with this model only. So we have RB, R pi, R mu, and R naught, and we have Gm, P pi. So already you know how to calculate the different H parameter model. So in order to calculate, so let me go back to that slide once again. So to calculate this H parameter model, you have to establish two different conditions. In the first condition, we have to establish that the output circuit is short circuited, so Vt is equal to zero, and accordingly you have to find out the ratio of V1 by I1 and I2 by I1. And on the other case, whenever you are making the input terminal open, I1 is equal to 0. So in that case, you can calculate H12 and H22. So considering this one, so let us start with the first condition. That means we are interested in finding out this H11 and H21. So in which case, we have to make these two terminals, this collector and emitter, the output terminal, shorted. That means V2 is equal to 0. V2, what is V2? V2 is nothing but this VCE. So we are making this is grounded. I mean, these two are together, these two are connected together. So it's a short-circuited kind of thing has been established over here. And we have VBE. VB is over here. Externally supplied voltage, VBE. And the current that is flowing is IB. Now we have to find out what is the relation between VB and IB. Now see, here, since this is grounded, I mean, this is, I'm assuming that emitter is grounded, kind of thing. So emitter is grounded. This is the common terminal. So since these two points are collector and emitter, these two are shorted, these two are connected together. So I can visualize that R pi and R mu, they are basically connected in shunt. R pi and R mu, they are connected in shunt. Now, for this particular voltage VB, the current that is flowing is IB. So through RB, the current that is flowing is IB. Now at point B dashed, this current will be divided into two different segments. One part will flow through this R pi, and the other part will flow through this R pi, through R mu, and through the short circuited path. So obviously, for this particular current IB, it will observe a shunt kind of resistance at point B dashed. So two resistances are connected in shunt. One is R pi, second one is R mu. So what will be the equivalent resistance? So the equivalent resistance, as seen by the current IB, is R pi parallel R mu. This is the equivalent resistance at point B dashed. And before that, you have this RB, this resistance. So RB plus R pi parallel R mu. So this is nothing but the relationship between VBE and IB. I mean, the ratio of VBE by IB. So that I can represent by means of HIE. So HIE is represented by RB plus R pi parallel R mu. Because what is HIE? Or how to calculate HIE? HIE is given by VBE by IB with VC is equal to 0. Output terminal shorted. So output shorted, VB is equal to IBRB plus R pi parallel R mu into IB. The equivalent resistance here, R pi parallel R mu. Because R naught and ground, so this, I mean, R naught and this is a zero resistance path. C and E, they are connected together. So short circuited path, so zero resistance. So zero and R naught, they are connected in shunt. What is equivalent resistance? That is zero. Zero and R pi, fine, in the series path. So it will be, zero and R mu in the series path. So it will be R mu. So R mu and R pi in shunt path and RB in series. So RB plus R pi parallel R mu. Now, if I do some approximation, we know that R mu is typically very large with respect to this R pi, typically very large with respect to R pi, and RB is also very, very small with respect to this R pi. So this HIE can be approximated to R pi only, because anything in the shunt path, if it is very large, I can neglect, and anything in the series path, which is very small, I can neglect. So RB can be neglected since it is in the series path, and R mu can be neglected since it is in the shunt path. So HIE is typically equal to R pi. So this particular equation relates one variable in the H parameter model to the other variable in the pi model. So HIE and R pi, they are related by means of this. Now we have the other variables as well. So what is that variable? That variable is the HFE. The next variable is the HFE. What was HFE? How to write HFE? So HFE is represented by I2 by I1. So what is I2 here? I2 is here IC. So the current that is here entering is IC. This is the current IC. So IC by IB with VC is equal to zero. So already we have short circuited the output terminal. So what will be the value of IC? So IC here is equal to GM times V pi. IC is equal to GM times V pi. That is the current which is entering the terminal, GM times V pi. Now how to represent V pi? V pi is nothing but, so once again, if I just make some approximation that here our mu can be neglected to some extent because our mu is very large. So for rough hand calculation, I can represent V pi as IV times R pi, assuming that almost all the current will flow through this R pi, although very insignificant amount of current will flow through our mu component because it is very large. So instead of writing V pi, what I can write is GM times IV times R pi. So if I want to calculate IC by IV with VC is equal to zero, that is coming like GM times R pi, GM times R pi. And already I've seen that GM R pi, this is nothing but the beta, the current gain of the transistor. So HFE is equal to beta. So HFE coming from the hybrid parameter model is equivalent to beta. So I can represent this by means of GM times V pi, or I can also represent in terms of beta times IV. So both of them are equal or equivalent. Either I represent this current source as GM times V pi, or equivalently I can also represent it by beta times IV. So it doesn't make any change. It doesn't make any difference. So GM V pi either represent in terms of a voltage dependent current source, that means GM times V pi, or you also represent by means of a current dependent current source, beta times IV. So both of them are having the same implication, same meaning. So by means of these two, we can calculate or we can establish the relationship between the H parameter model and the pi model, R pi and beta, with HI and HFE respectively. Now let us consider the calculation of other two models, I mean other two variables. For this, you need to make the input terminal open in order to calculate H12 and H22. Now you have RB over here. You have R pi. This is RB. You have R not over here. So now I have VC over here. So I have to observe. So if I supply a VC between these two points, now let us check what is the corresponding change that is taking place in terms of VBE and in terms of IC. So this is R0. So this is your V pi, voltage drop across R pi. This is V pi. This is R mu. This is GM times V pi. Either you represent in terms of GM V pi or you represent in terms of beta times IV. Now here, IV is equal to zero. Input terminal is open circuited. IV is equal to zero because to calculate this H12 and H22, or in other words, HRE, and HOE, you have to make the input open. So that's why there is no connection here, input is open. Now you have to find out what is the relationship over here. So current that is entering here is IC, the collector. Now we have to find out the relationship between VCE and V pi. So here you apply the voltage over here, that is VCE. You apply the voltage. The voltage difference here is VCE. Between these two terminals, it is VCE. Output terminal, it is VCE. And you have R pi and R mu. They are in the series path, kind of this, R pi and R mu. And the voltage that is dropped across this R pi is your V pi, because no current will flow through this path because this is already open. So if the voltage over here is VCE, voltage difference between these two points is VCE, and so this voltage drop is equal to VCE, and you have R pi R mu combination like this. So if I apply a simple voltage divider law, so here you find that VBE, this voltage is equal to V pi, because there is no drop across RB, because this voltage is VBE, this voltage, this open circuit voltage is VBE, that is equal to V pi, because there is no current flowing through this, and that is equal to VCE multiplied with R pi divided by R pi plus R mu. So this is the relationship between VBE and VCE. So how to calculate this H of RE? So H of RE, as you know, H of RE is the reverse voltage gain. So H of RE is represented by VBE, the input voltage, divided by the output voltage, VBE by VCE, with input circuit IB open, IB zero. So VBE by VCE is nothing but R pi upon R pi plus R mu. Now, as you know, R pi is much, much small as compared to R mu. So that could have been represented. So I can simply write, since R pi is very, very small with respect to R mu, so in the denominator, instead of writing R pi plus R mu, I can simply write safely R mu only, because R pi is in the order of few kilo ohms and R mu is in the order of few mega ohms, very large. So R pi plus R mu can be neglected or can be substituted by R mu only. And once again, if I find out this ratio R pi by R mu, once again, this is very small, and that could have been approximated to zero. So for ideal calculation, ideally I can calculate the value like this, R pi by R pi plus R mu. But for rough end calculation, you can always equate this value to be zero, because it is very small. If you just put the exact value for R pi and R mu, you'll see that the dependence of HRE is very small. So this HRE can be substituted or can be approximated to zero. Now comes the last element. This is nothing but your HOE. So in order to calculate HOE, I have to apply KCL at this particular point. I have to apply KCL. So if I want to apply KCL over here, so the current that is flowing is IC. So this current IC is having different component over here. One current is flowing, one current is the GM V pi component, GM V pi, this is the one component. Another current is VCE by R naught. This is the second component. And the third component is through this path. So what is the resistance, equivalent resistance over here? You have to find out the equivalent resistance over here, and accordingly you need to put the value. So the equivalent resistance over here, so VC is the voltage between these two terminal. Obviously there should not be any current flowing through this, because base current is equal to zero. So here the resistance is equal to, between these two paths, is R naught, and here GM V pi is the current source, and here the currents, here the resistance is R pi plus R mu. This is the combination. VC by R pi plus R mu. R pi plus R mu. So what is VC by R pi by R mu? So VC by R pi plus R mu is nothing but V pi by R pi. V pi by R pi. Or what you can do is, you have to represent this with respect to, because ultimately, or otherwise, what you can do is GM V pi. So you have to represent this GM. So instead of writing V pi, what I can write is R pi into VC. So I'm just representing in terms of VC only. So V pi is equal to VC into R pi divided by R pi plus R mu. Plus you have VC by R naught plus you have VC by R pi plus R mu. So this is equal to GM R pi is nothing but beta. GM R pi is nothing but beta. So I can write beta times R pi plus R mu into VC plus VC by R naught plus VC by R pi plus R mu. So going to the next slide, I write IC. One is VC by, let me check, what was the VC by R naught? VC by R naught. VC by R naught is there. Then you have VC by R pi plus R mu, and you have beta by R pi plus R mu into VC. So if I calculate IC by VC, that ratio is coming like 1 by R naught plus 1 plus beta times 1 plus beta upon R pi plus R mu. 1 plus beta upon R pi plus R mu. So once again, let us make this approximation that R pi is much, much smaller than R mu. Then this one would have been approximated when, once again, beta is very, very large. So I can make this equivalent to like beta by R mu only. So IC by VC will give us with IB is equal to zero, will give us the value for HOE. So this HOE is coming like beta by R mu, approximated to beta by R mu, and R mu is very small, R mu is very large. So 1 by R mu and beta times beta by R mu is very small. So I can neglect this one and I can write this by 1 by R naught only, approximated to 1 by R naught. Otherwise, you have a parallel combination of two resistances. You have parallel combination of two resistances, shunt combination. So that's why the admittances are added. So what are those two resistances? One is R naught and second one is R pi plus R mu by 1 plus beta. So basically there are two resistances. This is nothing but equivalently I can write, you have two resistances. You have two resistances over here. This is R naught and this is R pi plus R mu by 1 plus beta. So these two resistances are connected in shunt. So what will be the equivalent resistance? R equivalent. R equivalent is nothing but the parallel combination of this R naught parallel R pi plus R mu by 1 plus beta. Or in terms of this conductance, what I can write is 1 by R naught plus 1 plus beta by R pi plus R mu is nothing but 1 by R equivalent. Now, since this resistance is very large, R pi plus R mu by 1 plus beta, since R mu is very large and it is in the shunt path with respect to R naught, since it is very large, so I can neglect this one and I can represent this HOE by means of only 1 by R naught. So once again, this particular relation equates one variable in the H parameter model, this HOE, with the output resistance of the pi model. So ultimately what we can see is these different models, this H parameter model and the pi model. So these models are used to represent the bipolar junction transistor for their application, but eventually there is a significance relationship, there is significance dependence of one variable to the other. For example, this HIE in the H parameter model is equivalent to R pi, HFE in the H parameter model is equivalent to beta, HRE is normally very small and can be equated to zero, but if it is not zero, then this HRE can be represented by R pi by R pi plus R mu. So once again, it's a function of the pi model or extended pi model, and ultimately the HOE or the output admittance is equal to 1 by R naught. So by means of this, we can use any of these models as far as our requirement is concerned, and accordingly we can devise the, or we can calculate the current gain or voltage gain or the input impedance or the output impedance using any of these models for our calculation. So with this, let me stop today's discussion.